Hey everybody, welcome to Stoned React. So glad you're all here joining me today. I know it's been a while, but here I am. We are going to do a reaction to two of our videos. One of the videos is called I Have Some Important Things to Say. This was posted yesterday. And we're going to check out and see what she has to say. The next video is her eating that enormous sandwich and I don't know. I didn't watch the whole thing because I wanted to react to it as I was watching it. So let's get into this.
Hi guys. Welcome back to another video. So I just invented a little mini series right now. This might be the only episode. We'll see. You know how I am. But I basically wanted to talk about, it's called Tea Talk. At least this one episode is. And I'm just gonna have some tea and talk about things that are on my mind, you know, use you guys as kind of a diary and just talk about stuff that's on my mind and my life and things that I wanna talk about.
Okay, so I've actually heard of Tea Talk. I know there are some channels that do that. And likely what she did is she tries to find trends. I mean, we know Chantal, she's a very much a trend follower. She likes trends. She hops on board immediately without doing any type of research, even trying to figure out if she can do it, if it's possible. She just dives right in. We all know this about her, so let's get into it.
You know? So today is going to be a subject about, I guess, a comment that really makes me reflect. That I see a lot, and it's the comment is, and I've seen it many, many times, and I still get this, and it's that we miss the old foodie beauty.
People. Well, there is a level of we miss the old foodie beauty, just because that was the authentic, real self of you. I mean, okay, there are parts that showed more prominently when you were drinking alcohol or consuming substances, because we all know, right, when you consume certain substances such as alcohol, your real self comes out, right? You just, like, the filter comes off, you start saying stuff that you normally wouldn't say. It's kind of like when you wake up the next day and you're like, oh my god, what did I do, what did I say, you know, you have that type of, yeah.
People go through different phases of life. They go through growth. A human being is supposed to.
This is what I have a problem with, is when she says she's going through growth, we're not seeing the growth, and that's the big problem. She's still who she is, where she's at, but nothing has changed. The only thing that's changed is she's intensely more unhappy. I mean, it's very obvious. She doesn't feel, it doesn't feel like there's a flow for her. Like, it doesn't feel natural with the environment she's in right now, the relationships she's in right now. It doesn't feel natural. Something feels off. We all feel it. We're all like, there's something wrong with this picture. It's just, it's not genuine to who she is, because those of us who have been following her for years know truly what Chantal is, okay? She is narcissistic. She definitely has different personality disorders going on there. She's impulsive. She doesn't think of consequences. There's a whole lot to Chantal, okay? So anything, when she tries to say that she's trying to be genuine, she's trying to clean up her act or whatnot, I have a hard time believing it, because I know what kind of a compulsive liar she is. I know that she will do mostly anything for money. It was truly evident when we saw her in the recent last couple of years, when she was in this enormously toxic relationship, strutting on the YouTube, practically naked, acting like a complete fool. And we all saw that. We all saw that behavior.
Grow as a person. And the past, you know, we're supposed to learn from it and take what we need and leave the rest behind, you know? Now, for me, a lot of my past in the past couple of years, past few years even, is completely dead to me. Like, it's, and I've realized this, I've had to grieve it. I've gone through a lot of grief. I've gone through a lot of processing. And for me, I think I've gone through a lot of self-growth. And maybe I don't discuss that enough online, so I don't mind talking more about certain subjects like that. But today I'm going to focus more on, you know, I could talk about different areas of my life where I have grown and have improved. Other than my weight issue.
I haven't seen one thing that has improved in her. I mean, okay, let's say, and I can use myself as an example. I was very, I want to say anti-religion, but I questioned faith a lot in my early years, late teens, early 20s. And then I kind of jumped out of that phase and built upon myself and became more knowledgeable in my faith. And as years went on, I became more and more faithful, and I became more and more consistent, and I was participating more in the church and whatever it is. Like, you'll see changes in a person. It's not necessarily like somebody, you know, we're not expecting Chantal to recite Quran verses to us, but the things that we would typically see that changes in a person, or is their morals, their judgment, their integrity, their values. You start to see things that are like fundamental core things that change about a person. They tend to do right more than they tend to do wrong. Their reasoning for doing things is not as selfish as they once were. Chantal, from what I can see, everything she does is very selfishly induced. She's still like that. I don't see that at all changing. I mean, we can see it when it comes to how she eats, right? She orders out food all the time. If she doesn't get her way, where she's cut off from that, she's cooking food, she complains nonstop, right? She complains, oh, the floor is greasy. Oh, the kitchen's dirty. Oh, it's hard to move around. Oh, this, oh, that. She has every excuse not to cook in the kitchen. And that complaining, I'm sure, wears at him, right? And he's like, okay, fine. We'll get you a sandwich. And that's what happens. Okay. She gets her way. She's really, really good at manipulating. You know, she's kind of like I would call her like a manipulator or something. She does it like underneath, you know. She's not like in your face much of the time about it, but she's a manipulator, believe me. Because, you know, over there, women don't have that kind of power and control that like you would have in the West. Okay, so she is using her manipulation to work around things that are, you know, that would be challenging for her. But we haven't seen anything change. I don't see her like talking about, we went to the mosque. This was my experience. I'm trying to be more consistent. Okay, this week I went again. Oh, last week I skipped out. I made excuses. I should have went, but I'm going to get up and I'm going to go this week. So she goes on Friday to the mosque. Then we see her the next week. She goes to the mosque and she shares her experiences of what it was like spiritually for her, what the experience was like. What did the mosque look like? What were they talking about? What was the preaching in that mosque? What was the topic? What were they talking about? How did it relate to your life? How did you connect the message to you? And what did you take away from it? These are things I don't hear from her. And as someone who has grown in her faith over the last 30, 40 years, I can tell you, you get really solid in what your values are, your beliefs, what you stand for in things, and you remain consistent in those things as long as you're consistent with your faith. We don't see that with Chantal. We don't see any type of impactful change in her. And it's upsetting because she keeps talking about how she's changed and stuff, but she never notes anything significant. Just because you move somewhere and married someone and put a hijab on does not mean you've changed. That is all surface level. What she has done, the clothes, the move, the marriage, that's all surface level. There's nothing deep to that. What's deep to it is, how have you nurtured your relationship with your husband? How is your husband good to you? What special things does he do for you that makes you feel special? What makes you feel loved? What specific things do you guys do for each other to show each other how much you love each other? You know, do you guys study together the Quran? How does he help you become a better Muslim since he was born a Muslim? What does he do? How does he teach you? Does his sisters teach? teach you? Do his cousins teach you? What is it like when you get together at family gatherings? What type of conversations do you have? What are the personalities like of those family members that you have met so far? This is not like you have to give some type of deep dive information. Surface level, just give us something. Make us feel like your relationship has any type of depth. Now, she'll argue. She'll say, we all know what she'll say, right? She'll say, I choose to keep my life private. I'm not going to talk about everything. Okay. That has nothing to do with anything. If you're going to family gatherings, you're not giving any names, you're not giving dates, times, locations. You're just talking about the experience. There's nothing wrong with that. There's not, the, nothing is being disclosed in that conversation other than your experience and how you felt and what it was like to be there. This whole wearing the hijab, eating halal, all this stuff, and this is haram, and this is haram, and this is all this stuff. Okay, this is all surface level. We're not seeing any real, genuine change when it comes to her personality, her values, her integrity. N none of this stuff. She's still a liar. She's still a con. She's still somebody who is stuck in a time warp because she repeatedly talks about stories of her past. She makes up shit all the time. Okay, she's not a good person. She's not a genuine good person. When she's talking to you, you're seeing through every word. And that's why she cannot have good, solid relationships, whether friends, husband, whatever. She probably has a hard time making relationships.
Literally, that's, I talk ad nauseam about that. That's evident because that's a problem on the outside that's very visible, but internal issues that you can't see, that I'm more comfortable that I'm comfortable with talking about now, I don't mind. So I think that the me that you guys miss, I don't think that was the real me. So I've done some reflection on that, and I was thinking, like, am I fake? Like, what is the real me? Because I'm still discovering who I am in a lot of ways, but I have done a lot of that self-discovery. I have to say, I think that the foodie beauty you're missing, in a lot of ways, was a foodie beauty that was meant to entertain you. That was a kind of a persona. Now, not all of it, not all of it. I do have a very silly side, and that still does come out once in a while. But I find that it's not as natural as it was. A lot of the time, dancing around, acting silly, all these things, I really did it just to have fun and entertain you guys. But now I feel like older. Like, I really feel that in the past year, I've matured a lot.
I'm going to tell you why I think she feels older. She feels older because she's dressing more modestly, right? She's not wearing as much makeup as often. I mean, she does put her makeup on once in a while, but she is living a much more stagnant life. I mean, she doesn't move around nearly as much as she used to when she was Canada. If we remember when she'd go in Canada, she'd go up and down the steps frequently. She would be in her car driving around. Even if she was picking up food, she was at least getting out. She would go to the clothing store, she would go here, there, the pharmacy. Like, she would go places. She'd have some type of productivity going on in her day. Here it's very different. And what happens is, like, it's not even just how she's dressed, but it is drastically different. Okay, so being covered up probably makes her feel older in a sense, but the her inability to get around to do things probably makes her feel aged as well. Sitting around all day doing nothing probably makes her feel she's in a very different environment, and we know that she's probably very socially awkward. So she probably doesn't do well in particular with those women that are from there. I can tell you, I can almost guarantee there's an issue just because, my family comes from the Middle East area, and this we'd see through this. Like, we'd know what type of woman she was. She's probably like a backstabber. Like, that's how she would come off to me. But she probably has a hard time, to be in those type of social situations.
in a lot of ways. And that's, I think I've learned a lot of hard lessons.
And just to expand on that, the reason why she'd have a hard time building his relationships with these other women, because she just can't, it's just not there. That probably makes her feel older too, because usually running around other women, it brings out a little youthfulness in you, when you guys, laugh about things and all that. She doesn't have that. She really doesn't have anything making her want to feel young. She doesn't do anything that would make her feel young. Like, why don't you go to a spa? Why don't you get your nails done? Get a facial. I mean, I'm sure they have old lady spas there. There's no doubt. Why don't Sala get her a nice gift certificate, a nice package, half day, full day, whatever. Spend a few a few hundred bucks. Let her have her day. Okay, us women love spa days. So let her have her day. Okay, that will help you feel younger. It will make you feel more pretty. There are things that she could do to make herself feel better, feel younger. Feeling older isn't a bad thing, but I've always been of the mindset like your age is in your mind. Like, you are how you think you are. Like, I try to li live youthful and enjoy life. Like, some people aren't like that, but she just has to realize that the environment's completely different. This environment doesn't fit her. She seems so off. Like every time I see her in Kuwait, it doesn't feel natural. Canada felt natural. She felt like she was in her habitat. This doesn't feel natural because she can't maneuver around this. It's very different. It's very restrictive. And that, in a sense, can make you feel old. Like you no longer can do these things. And her body also, the amount of food she's consuming, how much weight she's gained. And no, I don't believe she's under 400. I believe she's over 400. The food she's consuming, her lack of movement, exercise, any type of walking, anything like that, she lacks that a lot compared to Canada. Your body starts to lose its strength. It loses its flexibility, and you do start to feel old even physically.
It's about life, and like I said, I've had to grieve my past. My cup kind of matches. I've had to kind of grieve a lot of things, and that made my trip back to Canada the last time I was there very hard. My life in Canada was in shambles, and I think a lot of people forget that. I think that that was very entertaining for you guys. Some people found me entertaining. They found me silly. They found me open. I would talk about everything. Nothing was private for me. Nothing was sacred. I just let everything.
It's not really that she talked about everything. She lied about everything. I mean, she's a liar, right? Like, even if she says she talked about everything, much of it was all lies.
Everything out. And I've said this before, but I repeat myself. There's a lot of value in not telling everyone what's going on in your life. The only people that really need to know are people who are actually really close to me in life.
In all honesty, Chantal, we don't care to know the specific details about your life, but if you would give us some content like your experiences, your things that you've done, things that you've learned, how you've applied it in your life. I mean, you can go in the direction of faith, you can go in a direction of culture, you can go in a direction of interacting with the family. And again, it's not that you have to say names, dates, times, and telephone numbers. Nobody cares about that. We want to hear about experiences because I've never lived in Kuwait. I've never lived overseas. I've never been to Kuwait. I don't know anybody from Kuwait. I find it interesting. I would love to learn more. But she doesn't give that. It's all about her. It's like me, 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 me. Poor me. Eat. I gotta eat. Me. I gotta do this. Me. I gotta go to another country to do my visa. Me, me, me. Thailand. Me, me, me. It's Cuba. Me, me, me. Everything's like me. It's all about her.
Life, and I like it that way. I like my valued privacy that I didn't have before, and I think that's one thing that you guys miss, obviously, is my pride is not being so private because
I don't know what I don't get it. She keeps talking about, I'm more private, I'm more private. She's completely shut down the conversation. I mean, there's no real content anywhere. I mean, okay, she went to Thailand. The beginning was a little interesting, but then it got boring, right? Because we were all like, okay, you like overdid your stay there. What else are you gonna see? They were running out of money. She doesn't, there's no depth to any of her content. She offers nothing. It has nothing to do with privacy. It has to do with content. There's nothing. She has no focus on her channel. It's just about Chantal and me. Well, okay, the channel's about you, so you got to talk about you. If you're not going to talk about you, change your channel. Do something different.
It was entertaining, there was always tea, there was always drama in my life, there was always something going on that people had to just, lit people. I remember hearing reactors say, we literally have to, like, it's interrupting our lives, there's so much going on, we have to get up in the middle of the night when Foodie Beauty goes live, because I would just go live at impromptu.
Wait, what? How many of y'all were losing sleep over Chantal and what time she was coming on and off the YouTube? Like, I could give two shits. Like, if the video's there and I see it, great. If it's not, not my loss. Like, I don't understand. Is there really people that sit up all night waiting for Chantal's videos to come? Okay, I do know that there's these individuals out there that tape the videos as they're going because they make a they post it again so that people can see it when she deletes them. I know that goes on. I don't know. They must have some type of maybe automatic programming on their computer that they're able to like trigger it. I can't imagine somebody sitting in front of their computer all day. I don't see it. Unless like you're on disability and you have absolutely nothing else to do with your life, but I can't figure out any other reason. She really thinks she's something, doesn't she? Oh, I know. People were saying they're waiting up all night for me to go on live because I just go on live anytime. People were just racking their brains. I mean, oh, it was so much drama. They were like waking up in the middle of the night. What? Please, people, don't do that. She's not worth it. Don't lose sleep over this woman.
Times, and just literally wake up, go live, and take you everywhere with me, And there was a lot of, I was like invading my own privacy by doing that in a lot of ways, I was never one to really air my relationships online. I was very private, and I still am now with that, with my husband and I.
She might think that she's being private about it, but we can all see through it. This is not a normal relationship. There is no fusion chemistry, nothing going on here, nothing to see, no affection. I mean, even when they hug, I feel a cringe in my body. Like it feels so unnatural. There is no chemistry at all. There's nothing that I feel nothing between them two. I can't even imagine how awkward it must feel for them. Well, in particular, Sala. I think Chantal can hug, kiss, and fuck anybody. I think she's just like a free for all. But I think Sala probably gets skeeved out a bit, with the over affection. I can't imagine he would enjoy that, but what do I know?
But being involved with somebody who's abusive, that was a different story. That I had no problem airing everything out. I think that those instances should definitely be exposed, but that was my situation when I was in Canada. I was involved with somebody.
Okay, so she has not stopped talking about Natter. I swear, every time I watch a video, she's talking about this SOB. If you were abused by someone, why would you continue to talk about them? Wouldn't the first thing you want to do is get that SOB out of your mind and talk about something else? She is so obsessed with this guy. She loves attention. She loves drama. I don't care what anybody says. Those are two things she absolutely loves, attention and drama. And Nader, he gave it. He was good for that. And she kind of molded into him perfectly, right? Because she likes drama and she loves attention. and she could have a ton of content because they were always arguing, fighting, cooking. I don't know what. There was something always going on. I mean, I watched that other video not too long ago when she showed up at his door. Remember when she was like stalking his house because she had to get her equipment? And he kept threat, you know, she kept saying, "I'm gonna call the police." I'm like thinking, like, you should have called the police once you arrived and just had them knock at the door. They'll get your CPAP machine. You don't even have to talk to the guy. And then go. But no, she had to make optimal drama, right? She had to stand at the door, duh, 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 and she's laughing. That's the disgusting part. She's laughing. That's why I don't believe her shit, okay? Who laughs when they're desperate to get their medical equipment from some psycho abuser? Why would you laugh? You sick fuck. I mean, like, who does that? The whole video, she's laughing. Now, if this was seriously an issue, the person would have went with the cops to the house. The cops would have told her, stay in the car, don't communicate with the guy, which is the right thing to do. The cops would have went to the door, gotten her stuff, brought it to her car, put it in the car. She wouldn't even have had to get out. She could have just left. But here she is talking about this guy again.
I was involved in a very toxic, narcissistic, abusive situation.
Chantal, you're toxic too. You contributed to the insanity.
But alhamdulillah, I'm so thankful to be out of. I was starting to believe in God, but the most of my time in Canada, I wasn't religious. And I would just be consuming, ordering large, you know, Box Mountain. I had heaps of boxes in my home. Because I was just ordering stuff I didn't need. It caused me to get into a lot of financial debt because I would just waste money like it was water. Like it actually, I had to grieve that. That's one of the biggest things I had to grieve was how irresponsible I've been financially. And, you know, I'm still cleaning that up and it might.
I mean, imagine, let's look at the financial portion of this. The amount of spending that she did, she probably maxed out all of her credit cards. I know there was time periods where she was making, you know, $20,000, $30,000 a month out of YouTube, but we know she's not making that kind of coin now. She probably maxed out all of her credit cards. She maxed out Pete's credit cards. We definitely know she's definitely done that. And she exhausted all the food deliveries apps because she's constantly complaining and getting refunds. So I'm sure none of them will really service her if she was ever to go back again, unless she goes under an alias. But yeah, okay,
Might
I'm
take
just
a
gonna.
while, you know.
Oh, I'm sorry, lost my train of thought. What I was gonna say is, when it comes to her finances, we have to remember she still owes taxes. She owes a big chunk of chain and ta change in taxes because she didn't pay taxes for years on this YouTube money that she made. So they had her on a payment plan. I don't know exactly how it works when it comes to her living in Kuwait. I know for sure the business is registered as a Canadian business, so she's making Canadian coin. So I don't know if she's paying those taxes through what she's making now, or she's completely defaulted on it, hoping the Canadian government doesn't go after her, which I doubt they would. They probably let people get away with this all the time. But anyway, I think that you know, she's got those taxes, she's got a lot of credit card debt. I would imagine that's got to be a heavy debt. I don't know how she would be paying it off with what she's making now. I mean, she would have to be bringing in a heck of a lot more money. I don't know. But I get curious about the financial stuff because we all know when she left Canada, she had a whopping debt.
No, but not doing it on my own is so much better. Like, and not having someone in my life who was also taking advantage of me and using me financially.
Chantal, okay, so the people were using you for a reason because you gave them the chance to use you. And let me explain how that works. You went into a relationship and you, from the start, bought his love. You were buying him clothes, you were buying him shoes, you were buying him apartments, you were buying him, I don't know what places to go, hotel rooms. She was the one spending all the money. She was even paying for the SOB's rent, okay? So she, when you do that in a relationship, Chantal, you enable a behavior because now that abuser latched on to you and gives you attention by the things you buy for him. So that is an exchange, right? She's purchasing something for the guy, and in return, he gives her attention. So she was buying his love. He didn't love her. He wouldn't even admit he slept with her.
Somebody who couldn't pay their rent, so I would help them with rent a few times. Somebody who couldn't even pay.
You're telling me all the time that you weren't in his life, he wasn't able to pay his rent. You don't think he could find another chick to cover? Come on.
Pay their own cigarettes. I would buy them like cigarettes. Like that adds up in Canada.
Well, you're
Cigarettes
stupid.
expensive. Stuff like that.
I don't know why she thinks anyone will feel bad for her. I don't feel an ounce bad for her. You're a fool. You did stupid things. You need to grow up. That's your money that you work for. Why would you just give it away? But see, she needs attention so bad. Like it's if she doesn't get attention, it just causes chaos to her. She can't. She has to have attention. And this is the only way she knows how to do it.
Somebody would say they needed money for their for like work uniform or something, like work equipment, and they would use it to gamble or buy drugs.
You're
I
stupid.
spent a lot of money on drugs. Like if I think of how much money I spent on that, it really makes me mad, But not anymore. Like I've learned to just move on and just grieve that. Grieve have leaving my pets behind. What happened with BBJ? That's all out of my mind now. I've grieved that situation.
How is that out of your mind, and how is it that you've grieved that? Because you have nonstop talked about it the last few weeks. I'm not. I don't believe. See, I think she BSs so much. I don't believe it for 1 minute.
So that it can't hurt me anymore. I just, you know what I mean? To me, she's already gone. She's already, you know what I mean? Like, I've just. That's it. She's already buried for me. I know Sam is okay. I get regular updates about him. So, that's not really hurting me. I know he's in a really good place right now. But like the BBJ thing, it's out of my hands. It's something that I've come to terms with. And, there's somebody who did that, who like took her just so they could use her for clout and they can use her to like dig it into me, Like I have your cat and you can make all the calendars you want. You can make all the merch.
Look, I agree with this tiny part of her comment here about the cat. I don't think the way it was going about getting the cat was the right way. I think that if she had done that, she should have never said a thing. As soon as she put the cat on camera, as soon as she started talking about what her plan had been and how she acquired the cat, I totally like I lost respect. Like I any little respect I had, I lost it. Like I don't understand why someone, if you really care about the cat, you'd acquire the cat and never say a thing. Just take care of the cat, be a good cat mom, and just continue on doing what you're doing without talking about the cat. It's a very weird, it's very uncomfortable. I don't like it. I think both of them are wrong in this situation. I think there's something twisted going on between these two. I don't know. There's way too much drama. I don't even watch her channel because that seems like an entire drama itself. I have enough of Foodie Beauty.
You want, I'm not letting it affect me, and it's done for me, So that past is gone for me. Like that whole abusive situation. I'm done abusing myself financially. I'm done wasting money. I'm done being material.
But didn't she send Sala like $10,000 or something to agree to marry her? And she continues to fund their entire relationship with her money? Chantal, if you didn't know, but in different cultures overseas, and in particular with the Muslims, they believe a woman, if she chooses to work, which she does not have to, that money belongs to her to do as she wishes. She is not obligated to give it to her husband. Her husband, however, is obligated to contribute and hold a family together financially, earn, protect, blah, 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 right? She is just, oh my God. She's so unaware. She's so unaware. Because, like, she wouldn't have this issue financially if she had a really decent man.
Realistic, and I'm done.
She could use the money she was earning to pay off her debts. But we know that's not happening because Sulla doesn't do anything either. He's like a big baby.
With so many things about my past that I don't miss, and I think in that way I've matured a lot. I have different priorities in life. I really want to just start really working on my health a lot more because I've gotten to a point where my whole life I just thought, oh, I have another day, I have another day, I have another day to neglect it. And here I am with all these health issues that in my mind, in the back of my mind, knew that I was at high risk of, and I was just in denial. I don't miss those behaviors of, dancing around half nude, all of that stuff. I find that, I have a different opinion on that. I have more self-respect in that way. I feel better covered. I feel like I'm respecting my body, like I'm respecting my femininity, my sexuality, and it's only for one person who respects me.
Hey, I'm all for the modesty. I'm all for the modesty. As a conservative, faith person, I can say I'm for it. I'm all supportive of the modesty. I'm so glad she's doing it. I'm so glad she's found that in her life. I'm happy. Okay? I have no issues with the clothes that she wears. That sometimes she looks way too frumpy. I think she can find some better styles, but I personally am happy to see her dressing modestly. I wish most people would. But that's just such a surface level thing, right? Faith is a much deeper, deeper thing, and I wish she would take us deeper, 'cause maybe we would learn something about her that we don't know.
And loves me. It's the only person who deserves to see that side of me. And before, I never thought that. I just used to think any attention from any male is good attention, you
No,
know?
it's not.
I used to think it was like a win to get as much male attention looking at me as possible. And now I feel like guarded. I feel like, no, they don't deserve it. They don't deserve that piece of me. The only person who deserves that is my husband
Hundred
because he
percent.
loves me, he respects me, he provides for me, he's my protector.
And don't forget, Chantal, your husband doesn't want you sporting your half-naked ass around town with other men looking at you. That's another thing too. It's out of respect for your husband, because no husband wants to be out in public and watching other guys gawking on his woman. It's disgusting.
And he's the only person that deserves to see that. He put a ring on it, he gets to see that and experience that side of me. Everyone has an intimate, private side, and it's not just about how you look, about how.
I still want to believe that they're married, but I have a hard time believing it. I feel like what they have is that temporary marriage, which is common in certain countries. And I did look up in Kuwait that it is something practiced there, which is a temporary marriage. You can do it for hours, weeks, days, months, years. I mean, it's a religious wedding. So no doubt do I think they did that. Yeah, sure. I mean, they're living together. They have to have some type of marriage, but I don't believe they have like a real marriage, like legally. I mean, which is fine, right? If you're married religiously, marriage itself should be under religion. Marriage is a religious ceremony and it's based on faith. So that would be considered a valid marriage. But she tries to pass it off like it's a legal marriage. I don't know.
Thin you are. It's about the chemistry and the relationship that you have with somebody. It's about that intimacy between two people. And that you could be with the most gorgeous person and not have that with someone, you know? So I think that that's also very important for me, having learned those values in Islam, to respect myself, you know? Like, Allah has, kind of, I hate to say ordered, but you know, has asked women to cover themselves with hijab, and that's to protect their sexuality, to protect from the—
Believe it or not, Chantal, there once was a time, way before Islam, even, that Christian women wore a veil. Even today, I have friends, Christian friends, who wear a head covering, whether a kerchief or a scarf or whatever, they cover their hair. And they do that out of respect for their husband as they're married. It actually isn't just a Muslim thing. You can find it in many different cultures. I mean, even Hasidic Jew, Orthodox Jewish women cover their hair. I mean, there's a lot of faiths that do that. I mean, it's not that uncommon, actually. I think in the West, we just don't notice it as much because there's not as many people who do that.
The eyes of everyone else to protect, save it just for one person, because a woman's beauty is very special in Islam. So when I hear people say, I miss the old you, the funny you, some people just miss me dressing up and doing skits and things like that. Yeah, I can understand. That was fun. That's fine. I could even maybe still do those things, but I guess I just don't really feel up to it these days. I feel more like sharing, maybe my trying to get well, stuff like that, you know, daily routines, things I cook, and just talking like this.
Yeah, I mean, look, Chantal, you're a wife now, okay? Supposedly this pious Muslim wife. So why don't you focus on showing stuff that focuses around that stuff? Like I said before, take us on your spiritual path, your path on faith. What have you learned? How have you applied it in life? How has it impacted you? What messages resonate with you most? Maybe every week, give us a verse out of the Quran and tell us what that means to you. What did you study about it? Cooking meals. People love watching people cook meals. Okay, you can do the video, the cooking part, in a way where you cut, you know, make cuts and make it so it flows, you know, put some relatable music to it or something like that in the background. I mean, there's so many things, you know, a cleaning video, like you could do that in your hijab and all that. You can pull out the vacuum and dust and stuff like that. You don't have to talk to us. You could just speed up the video. I mean, there's so many things you could do to show us how you're living your new life.
For now, you know, so I do want to get out more and show you guys more of Kuwait, and I do, you know, I want to plan our next travel together, and I kind of want to get back to writing, but I'm not sure. We'll see. I still just like to write little stupid stories, like, even though they were bad. But I think, I mean, like, more like nonfiction kind of thing. Because everyone's life is a story. Everyone could write a story.
Why don't you pick up a Kuwaiti or some Arab cuisine cookbook, okay? And why don't you pick a recipe every week and cook that particular meal? Why don't you try something different? You're not an Arab. You're not a Kuwaiti. You're not a Middle Eastern person. You're not familiar even with the food. So that would be a lot of fun. And at the same time, you would learn what? How to cook better. You would learn what? How to please your husband better by giving him meals that he would enjoy. You could become a better wife. You could become more talented in your skills. And we could come along and join you for the ride. But no, she won't do that.
Story on their life, you know? But anyway, I'm more at peace now, and I'm a lot happier, and that's the one thing that keeps me wanting to go back to Canada, is that I don't miss my past. I was very anxious to get the heck out of there and away from that life as fast as possible, and it doesn't mean that it hasn't followed me. It has. You've seen me freak out once or twice. I've been in a grieving state, you know, and the transition wasn't immediate. It's not like I moved here, took my shahada, and all my problems went away, my personality problems. No, I still was getting provoked into being angry, and I was still saying things that were hurtful to other people, which I've repented for, and I do feel bad for. I don't like to sink to that level. You know, I'm getting up there in age, and I think that the most important thing in life is really to just try to be the person that you wish other people would be towards you. You know, golden rule in Christianity, well, it applies to most religions, and it just applies to a basic human level, even if you're not religious. So I really want to just keep that up, keep my life as drama-free as possible, because I really think that that contributes to a lot of mental illness, to a lot of illness in general. It brings down your aura. It just makes you feel like crap, makes you angry, makes you in a bad mood, and it's just, it's not productive to just sit there and talk about other people or to worry about what other people are thinking about you. You know, it just doesn't pay in any way. So no matter how much you miss that old me, how many people still watch my old videos, how many people still review my old videos, how many people still live in my past on the internet, I don't. And that's the most important thing. That's the only relevant thing, is where I am, where I'm at. I'm here in the present with my husband in another country, living in another country with a completely different outlook on life and new values. And waking up to get high every day and mask things that were eating away at my soul is not where I want to be ever again. I'm in a new chapter of my life. It was a bit of a hard transition sometimes because, like I said, you know, learning things and learning to use those things and just grieving a past, grieving things. You know, I have a lot of things to grieve in my life. You know, still grieving my grandmother. Like I said, my pets, because whether you believe it or not, they were a big part of my life. And, you know, I made the decision I thought was right, the best decision. But that's, I've learned to grieve that. I think I'm getting to a point where I am accepting that that part of my life is just gone, and learning to clean up a lot of the damage, emotional, financial, everything that's come along with living that life for so long, you know? And that's it. Even people admit it. That's why you like to watch me back then. I was a train wreck, you know, but it's someone's life. This is my real life. It's not just entertainment, and it's realistically, it's, you know, it's not scripted, so it's not going to stay messy if I want to have a good quality of life. And I do. So, you know, you know, my life might seem a bit more boring if you were in it for the drama. Of course, it's going to be a lot more boring, but boring is peace for me, and I like that. So, yeah, when I hear that, you know, what happened to you? What happened to me? Well, a lot has happened to me. A lot has happened to me, and it's been a ride. But I really think I've found nobody's perfect, but I'd say perfect for me, partner in Salah. And there's so much I love about being in Kuwait in the Middle East, living wise, than living when I was living in Canada. And there are things I miss, of course, you know, friends, family, stuff like that. But, you know, inshallah, I will see them again one day. So yeah, even if I did go back to Canada, I would not be the same. Even when I went back last time, I wasn't really, you know, I didn't do a lot of the things I used to do, but I don't know that I would even go live all the time. I would probably just make videos.
Oh, you know, the temptation would be everywhere for her. And we all know that if she went back, she would fall into the temptation quite easily. What with the weed? Definitely the weed. She enjoyed the feeling of being on the weed. It made her feel like uninhibited. She could just let loose. Like, I totally get it. I smoke weed every day for medical reasons, but I enjoy it. I get it. I would imagine she misses that. And I do think that she misses her ability to be mobile, the familiarity of Canada, her knowing where to go. She's native to there. Like, it feels more like home. And the only reason I could say she would want to not go is because she wants to prevent herself from slipping up and prevent herself. So she knows that if she goes to Canada, it's going to go bad. So she figures, if I don't go, if I just avoid it, it won't be a problem.
Or maybe not even tell you guys, you know? Maybe just
Ooh, big
go and just take a
secrets.
break from the internet. I don't
If you took any type of break, we'd all assume you were in Canada.
know. But I definitely, even though I struggle sometimes with some changes, overall I do enjoy more being here in this life. And there are things happening to my.
I would imagine as time passes, if you move to a new place, it's probably really hard the first year. I know I moved to a different state years ago from the East Coast to the West Coast, and it was total culture shock for me. It was very different. It definitely took me a year to get used to it, and then I started becoming more like, chill and stuff because the Northeast were a little uptight. But yeah, it took about a year, and then as each year passes by, it gets easier. You get more familiar with things. You kind of know how everything works. You know where places are and how to do things. So, I'm sure as time passes, she'll probably get more and more comfortable.
Personality, I think it's just like I think this is my normal personality when I'm not trying to put on a show and be silly and make you guys laugh, you
I don't
know.
believe that.
Naturally, I'm kind of a funny person, like I'm a bit silly in my personality naturally, but as you grow older, I think that just change dims down a little bit. I don't know. I'm not forcing anything. This is just how I've been. I'm not trying to.
Chantal, you're just turning 40, right? You think you feel old. Wait till you hit your 50s. No, seriously, I hope she is maturing. I hope that in some way this whole transition is helping her to grow up and become more of a woman with responsibilities and make responsible decisions and stop lying. But I feel like this is never going to end, that she just kind of put it in a file cabinet somewhere, and like one day it's all just going to pop out again. It's kind of like when she has her rages, you never really see it. You kind of see it coming, but then poof, it happens.
To put on a special persona to seem more angelic or anything like that. This is just, I'm more calm, I'm more at peace, and I'm not just how I'm acting naturally, you know? So, anyways, guys, I think that's it for this video. I just wanted to talk a little bit, and I will make more videos like this in the future, inshallah. But, anyways, I wish you all a wonderful evening, and I'll talk to you soon. Bye!
Okay, so that was that. So let's go ahead to the next video. Okay, so this next video we're going to dive into is eating sub stop for lunch and where it all began. And this was posted roughly 23 hours ago. And we're going to get into it.
I feel like it's impossible to overcome. I feel like defeated.
Wait. That's so weird. Wait.
Hi guys, Salami.
Oh, okay. I was like, wait a minute. Did she like cut out the whole beginning of the video? Okay, never mind.
Welcome back to another video. So today I have something that will
Freak
make
us out.
you judge me hardcore.
Yes, we are gonna judge you hardcore. That's
But
what we're
before you
here
do,
for.
I have a lot of stuff to share with you guys. I have cat hair all over my face. I was
That's great.
kissing my cat to death and it's all over me now. So, what I'm gonna have today, what I'm eating right now is sub stop and 6-inch sub of different kind with some chips. I'm gonna start with one sub. Keep the spare sandwich. One chip should be enough for now. We'll see. Some
Let's
sugars. What do you?
move this
What
along.
I've discovered is, and what I want to share with you,
Oh boy.
I don't want to share just the good times. Bismillah. with you. I want to share when I'm struggling also. And clearly I'm struggling getting rid of food that's been comforting me for years. So let me get into that.
I mean, it's pretty wild, right? We went from she's going to do a water fast, right? She apparently did a water fast for a duration of time. I don't believe that. She said some, like, I don't know, 18 hours or so. I forget what the number was, but she stated she had done that water fast. Then she was going to do a ketovore, carnivore, keto type thing, which I was like, yes, okay, because I am very pro carnivore, keto. I think it's the way to go if you want to live your healthy life. But as we can see, she has returned back to eating an unhealthy meal. Now, I can't keep my eyes off of the juice glass that is sitting on the left side of the screen, the bottom left side, which is probably pomegranate juice, I'm guessing. That's a lot of juice. It's a big glass. You'll see it when she lifts her. Lifts the cup. When she lifts the cup, you're going to notice that's a big glass of juice. And that's a lot of sugar and a lot of calories. And she's got this enormous chicken sandwich and she's got these chips. What are we going to say? That juice has to be over 200 calories, I'm guessing. I don't even know what the sugar is. I'll have to look it up. But you got a sandwich there that is probably roughly 400, 500 calories. And then the chips, 200, 300, 400 calories. I'm not sure. It depends on what it's seasoned with. But yeah, it should be interesting.
Because it turns out having any kind of health issues doesn't seem to be enough sometimes to keep me from eating bad things. And I realized that, you know, I'm going to the doctor after and I need to get on medication, you know, like everyone was saying, until I can. I'm new here. I'm learning the healthcare system. I'm going to be trying to find help for my eating issues and stuff like that as well.
I mean, she's been there a year. She's even ordered food from dietary food companies. So it's not like she hasn't. I mean, she's been to the doctor how many times? I don't understand what she's trying to get familiar with, but okay. I mean, because she has no time, right? She's just so busy. Like, this entire year, she could have had the entire, everything memorized by now.
So I'll keep you guys posted with that. But this is a 6-inch chicken teriyaki. Parmesan oregano bread. Lettuce, tomato, mayo. A sweet onion sauce. Southwest sauce. Jalapenos. Black olives.
She likes it spicy. And you guys are just gonna like die laughing how dirty she gets.
So I'm not trolling with this video.
You're not?
I'm just actually being very transparent. I'm showing how I struggle to stay on track most times. I'm having trouble like being able to be consistent with eating super clean. I feel like starving and like not satisfied because that food, clean food, is obviously not doesn't.
I'm telling you, Chantal, if you ate as much as possible protein, I know it's hard. I know. I've done it. I know my husband is consistent in that. I'm not, but I know it's hard. But if you eat, just consume as much protein as possible. Okay? And I mean protein. I'm not talking about junk protein. Like steak, beef, chicken, fish, and no rice, no potato, no gravy, no nothing. Just season it well and eat it. I'm telling you, once you get over like the first week, your appetite will start to decrease. You'll start to lose all those cravings for those chips and sweets and stuff like that you do. But it's so hard. I don't know how many times I tried. I go a couple days and then I eat something and it throws me off. It's really hard to be consistent with it, but once you are, it works phenomenally well. And I think that her health would be so much better and she'd start losing weight. She would feel better about herself. But she keeps going back to these comfort foods. And it's because she's sad. She's depressed. She's not happy. That's what a lot of times people do that. I think in particular, probably women do it more. Like we tend to throw our emotions into food and we comfort ourselves with that. And totally understandable, right? Like you have to find something, and some people turn to food. But if she just would break the cycle, I'm telling you, if she just could stick it out for a week. No sugars, minimal carbs. I mean, if you're going to have carbs, maybe have some cauliflower. If you have to have some fruit, have blackberries, right? That's keto friendly. Just stay away, just log everything you're eating. Use the chronometer. I'm telling you, that app, it tracks your micros and your macros. Like you even can see the micros. It's awesome. Okay, I'm going to stop. Sorry,
Satisfy
guys. I get very passionate about
anything
this.
except for health, which is it should be. So I need to learn how to cope, and I can't right now. And I find since having high blood sugar, I'm so ravenous all the time. Anyway. My obsession with food. The chunks of chicken here are so huge. Has been going on since I'm a child. From a very young age, McDonald's is like ingrained.
I would imagine when she was younger, they probably fed her a lot of fast food just to keep her shut up.
The Happy Meal, the toys. When I was a kid, the toys was Fraggle Rock. But for a long time, my mom was a single mom, and she had to work or,
Yeah, I know. My mom was a single
go to
mom too, yet
school.
she cooked all the time for me. And she worked three
On
jobs.
my dad's side? My grandparents on my dad's side are both dead. My grandfather on my dad's side was morbidly obese. I remember being a kid and being shocked at seeing him with his shirt off and how large he was. He died of a stroke in his 70s.
He lived a fairly long life considering.
And then my grandmother, heavy smoker. I remember she would always just be at the table cooking something, cracking open a Diet Coke and lighting a cigarette every few minutes, like every, you know, few minutes or so. She used to have me go in her closet and grab her a pack from her carton. Player's Light.
Well, that's how it was back then, Chantal. I used to go to a store and get cigarettes at a young age. They didn't even card us. They assumed you were getting it for your parents or some adult.
Her room was dark and cold. And felt haunted. And it didn't help that once she told me when her husband, my grandfather, passed away that she saw him in that room. That's the house with the ghost in the basement. Anyway. I looked forward to going because I knew I would be eating good. I was spoiled.
I mean, her whole life revolved around food, even at a young age. I mean, we can clearly see it. She just, no conversation ever happens unless something's happening about food. Like, she's always talking about food. Like, even when she talks about memories from her past, there's always connections to food.
So she would make me comforting meals. And snacks.
When she chews and that jaw locks, oof.
So comforting and memorable and ingrained in my memory that I still dream about being there. This is during a time in my childhood where my dad was more involved. So yeah, sometimes in my dreams, you know, even my food obsession follows me in my dreams. I have dreams of being back at my grandmother's house. She used to make these tiny little sweet and sour meatballs. They were so good. She would give me these little chicken nuggets with Diana's barbecue sauce. It was so good. Magic moments, butterscotch, or vanilla pudding. She would take a fresh loaf of bread, cut thick slices, and put thick slices of fresh, like St. Albert's cheese. If you're from Ontario, you know. St. Albert's cheese. And put it under the broiler. And I could still see her leaning over the oven to keep an eye. With a dart in her hand. But she used to get mad at me for asking for extra pudding. Excuse me. Even back then, she would tell my mom, you know. I think Chantal has a problem with food. She wouldn't keep asking for snacks.
My gosh, she's still chewing. Let's go.
Remember my first bag of chips? How it made me feel. Okay, so this is the second sandwich. It's the meat feast with pickles, olive, with
Oh wow, she
pickles,
ate
black
two
olives,
sandwiches.
lettuce, tomato, extra mayo, salt, pepper, and oil and vinegar on Parmesan oregano. It's kind of like their version of the cold cut trio, but it's like beef products, so it has roast beef, pepperoni, salami, but it's made with a different animal, except for maybe besides a pig, obviously, because Islam country.
No, all you have to say is we don't eat pork. That's the reality of it. You're a Muslim, you don't eat pork.
That's so good. But this franchise is like not affiliated with Subway. So they put so much pickles. Just to show you how far back. This obsession with food goes.
Oh my God, the crunching, I can't stand it. She's not saying anything, that's why I'm fast forwarding it. She's just stuffing her face. I wonder if I can speed this up. I've never done that before. Playback speed.
Yeah. But I still dream about. I told a lot of you this before.
There we go. Ah, oh, that's
Driving
better.
around in my dreams, visiting different fast food places. Or, good girl. Scratching her paws. Strolling along a street at night with like tons. Each row of the street on either side is lined with well-lit restaurants. and I'm overwhelmed with the choices. But I don't actually eat in my dream. It's weird. I don't know. So, it's very weird. One of my favorite foods is a good deli sandwich. I love the deli. Deli meat, deli cheese, deli pickles. You guys eat a 12-inch? Or do you think that's too much? I don't like eating subs or sandwiches without chips.
I actually like the chips in the sandwich. I don't know if that is a Philly thing or a Pennsylvania thing or what it is, but I love just salty potato chips in a hoagie or a sandwich. It just makes it or breaks it.
So yeah, I was like, I'm not gonna lie, I'm not gonna hide and pretend like I didn't eat this today. I wanna be transparent when it comes with battling this.
Oh yes, please be
transparent. Show that there's gonna be a lot of times like this. The reality of it. I don't know how to stop wanting this food. And if I'm gonna want it forever, that's gonna be really hard. All right, guys. I will see you after. I'll have a vlog out maybe later.
Okay, guys. Well, that was the end of that. It wasn't anything exciting. She did down those two sandwiches and tons of chips. And, you know, just to suffer along with her as she goes through this journey of trying to figure out how she can get control over eating, which she's been doing this for years. And we know it's just part of the cycle of life for Chantal. But anyway, leave your comments below. Hope you enjoyed the episode. And I will talk to you later.